Hi guys, it's me, Arden Leigh. I'm back here with a quick video. Hopefully this won't be too long. I'm actually running out to go to a concert soon, but I felt like this was something that I had to get off my chest before I could go about the rest of my day. So this is something that's been bubbling up in me a great deal, and I want to talk about the idea of where people are on their spiritual journeys. And where they are, you know, we can even take the word spiritual out of it. We can even call it personal growth or self-development or what have you. There's a reason those things are called journeys, because if we were given the clues to everything that we needed to know to feel okay about the world and about ourselves, it would be a shock to our systems. There's a reason that we have the element of time, you know? There's a reason that things happen step by step. And I think that for some people in the personal growth communities, it's really easy for us to forget that. And it's really easy for us to judge others for where they are on their path rather than the direction that they're going in. In fact, just last night, a Facebook friend of mine made a post about, hey, what are some of the red flags that you see in the spiritual community for people who are toxic, but covering up that toxicity with spiritual language? And someone wrote back and said, you know, when I see people who judge others as being like, oh, well, they're just so negative vibes or whatever, or they're, you know, their energy is bad, they're bringing me down, rather than just acknowledging where those people are at on their journeys. And I wrote back and I said, that's true. But also those people who are judging those other people are also at that place in their journey. And I think one of the reasons actually that people tend to do that, kind of spiritual bypassing, that people like to refer to that as, where they say, oh, that person is negative, that's bringing me down, is actually because they're probably only two or three steps ahead of that person. And that person's belief systems feel threatening to them because it's so easy to slip back. It's kind of almost like my understanding of sobriety. Like the first, like when you decide to get sober, you don't wanna go out to bars and be around people who, you know, maybe have drinking problems for your first couple months or however long it takes you, because it's so easy to fall back into that. I think that's a lot of where that judgment comes from. And I know for me too, I have had to have periods of time where I had to sort of like hit a pause button on people in my life, because it would have been so easy for me to fall back into those old beliefs. And I'm like, if I'm around this is not good for me, because I'm only two or three steps ahead. And as I progress on my journey, I'm going to be able to come back to those people and hang out and see them for where they're at and feel confident enough in where I'm at that it no longer feels like a threat to me. And I think that being able to see, like to zoom out and to really look at why we have the element of time is really wise and really smart. And to be able to really look and see patterns. And that's so much for me of what intuition is about. That's so much for me of what, you know, and maybe this is just personally how I do things. Maybe there are people who just get direct messages, you know, who hear or see things, and they're able to just, you know, give that information out to the world. But for me, I know that my abilities to perceive come from mainly an ability to look at patterns and to see what's happened in the past, what has changed, and where things are going, and to be able to look at an overall trajectory and understand what's happening. I think that is the primary skill set that I tend to function in when I'm doing my coaching, you know, when I'm doing readings, even if I don't know someone, you know, it still feels like that's the metric, the rubric that I'm using. Maybe that comes to me gnostically as well. I don't know. I'm not that far ahead yet. I guess I'll figure it out. But there was something really interesting that I read recently that I came across that I can't stop thinking about. And a friend of mine gifted me an audiobook of Viktor Frankl's The Search for Meaning, where he talks about his experience being in the World War II concentration camps and how it was holding on to hope, you know, holding on to an internal experience that helped him get through that is the main thrust of that book. And one thing that he talks about that was so fascinating is that when some of the prisoners were rescued from the camps, obviously they're starving. And when they were given food by the people who came to rescue them, what happened was the nutrients that they received were such a shock to their system that they went into, I want to say it was insulin shock or something that caused liver failure, and a lot of them died. And it was actually the prisoners who didn't get a whole lot of food right away who were able to reacclimate their systems to being fed. And I looked this up and it's called refeeding syndrome. And I was just blown away so hard because I think it's such a great metaphor for so many of us in the community who want people's growth to be instantaneous, especially when we're just getting there ourselves. And I know I've been guilty of this too. I know I've been terribly guilty of this, of being like, I see what's happening. I see what's going on, and I understand things, and I want to give you that gift too. And certainly, you know, for people who are seeking that out, I can help them and guide them through it. But even when they are, too much information coming in quickly, I've had this happen to me, so I can describe that from my own personal experience. When I ask for too much information, or I get too curious, you know, I go and I keep essentially telling the universe or whatever force has been guiding my intuition this last year, when I'm like, I'm ready, I want more, sometimes you get to a point where you're like, whoa, holy shit, that's too much, and that actually happened to me. That happened to me a couple weeks ago on the solar eclipse. And the solar eclipse, new moon solar eclipse in Pisces, I decide to launch a sigil for I am in the vibration of my soul's fulfillment, because I was like, yeah, I want to go for it. And if I can do that, if I can be responsible for my own personal growth and my own fulfillment, then all the other things that I've been wanting to call into myself will just naturally come into me, because I will already be in that vibration. And I was, so sure enough, I did a ritual, I launched a sigil, and 2 days later, I was just flooded with information that really knocked me off my feet. I was experiencing anxiety. It really felt like a panic attack. I was spinning out, and I got more and more of it, and I really had to process, and eventually, you know, it settled. You know, eventually I feel pretty good now. But sometimes I forget that I'm sort of at least lightly familiar with that process and what that means and what that's going to feel like. So even when I have that panic attack, I typically know how to ground and I understand what I need to do. So sure enough, I went down to San Diego, I saw my friend Ashley, and I just poured out all of this stuff that happened, and I went through and I processed it, and she was so great. She really helped me with that. And ultimately I came to settle. But I also have to remember that not everyone out there has those same tools. Not everyone out there has those same resources or even understands what is happening to them. And I look around at people in my life And I sense that they too may be on a transformational journey. And sometimes I'm like, man, I really feel for them because I know that I have a community, that I'm surrounded by people who, this is what we do. And we have each other as sounding boards. We have skill sets, and we have an understanding of what this tends to mean and tends to be like, and we have a lot of support. And I really feel for the people that I see in my life where I see them going through rapid changes, brutal self-examination. And don't get me wrong, I'm a fan of brutal self-examination. I think it's like, it always ends up being good, even if it's difficult. But wow, I really, and it's not my business to reach out to them. You know, I mean, certainly, of course, I can say, hey, I'm here if you need support. Let me know if you need to talk, whatever. And of course I do. But it's not my job to go in and do that for them. In fact, I can't at all. And sometimes when in the past, when I've tried to, even when I feel like I'm detached from outcome, even when a person is, by all appearances, accepting my help and saying, yes, I want to do this and I want to be happy, I want to get better. Oh man, it's so easy to do that in theory. It's so easy to say, I want to be happy, without knowing what being happy means giving up. I wrote something a year ago when I was at the start of my healing process. And what I wrote was, nobody ever tells you how much healing hurts. Nobody ever tells you that it's not about receiving brand new happy butterfly beliefs that immediately make you feel better. That it's actually about giving up your favorite fairy tales that maybe literally saved your life when you were a kid. And it feels like losing your home. To heal is to grieve. And that's what it felt like for me. When I started this path that I'm on right now, a year ago, I mean, you could argue I've been on a journey of healing for years now, but this past, you know, the start of 2016, I got really super serious about it. I was like, all right, I don't want to repeat the things I've done in the past. I'm done. That's over. And I really want to move forward and get different results this time. So I got really super real with myself. And it was like halfway through February, and I was like, this sucks. Oh my God, this is so bad. Nobody told me that I was going to have to give up these belief structures that I'm in that have been such a source of pleasure and joy to me. And I don't know if you guys have been following my work at all, but this past, in 2016, I was called to give up three of the primary characteristics by which I identified myself. Maybe not give them up entirely, but rather to knock out the pedestal that was propping them up. Seduction, ironically, right? Submission, also ironically, and polyamory, because I was looking at the ways that they really weren't serving my need for intimacy. And I kept saying I wanted intimacy, but my submission was being propped up by a feeling that I wasn't really worthy, that I wasn't really equal. I can still be submissive. I was so worried. I was like, well, if I knock out that core unworthiness narrative, am I even going to want to be submissive anymore? If I feel worthy of my partner, am I going to want to, you know, like, give blowjobs every day and cook a perfect steak and all that? And I can still do all of that as a choice, but I can't do it from a place of feeling like I need to overcompensate for either not being enough or conversely for being too much and having to make up for that. And for seduction, it was like, you know, I had to really examine, well, if I feel like I constantly have to be thinking 4, 5, 6, 12 steps ahead of someone, then that's really not allowing for intimacy, because I'm not letting them in on where I'm at the moment and where I feel that things are going to go. It's a great skill set to have. It allowed me to meet a lot of people. It allows me to put a lot of people at ease and be comfortable. And it still has all the virtues that I've praised for it, but ultimately, you know, it needs to not be a lifestyle. Like, people need to, if they're gonna be with me, they're gonna need to know what I'm thinking. And that involves, you know, either not planning a million steps ahead and calculating everything that I'm gonna do. And I've defended calculating for so many years. I've always said that calculating is merely the evil twin of considerate. You know, you're just thinking about something. You're just thinking about what someone wants or what will please them or what will make them happy. And that's great to do, but if you keep thinking about that, you're not allowing for that layer of intimacy. And I had a really big revelation in this past year where I'm like, man, the real you is the one who's like texting screenshots to your friends and saying, this is what's going on. Like, that's the you that you need to be with your partner if intimacy is what you're going for, you know? If you're just, you know, and in my pickup artist days, it was like, that's fine if that was the goal. I just wanted to go on a bunch of adventures and have a lot of fun. And that was terrific. That was cool. But if I'm looking to like be a fucking adult and get into a relationship that that really exemplifies emotional intimacy, then, you know, sure, I can plan surprises for someone. I can do things to please them and make them happy. I can learn them and make them better, but I can't hide the fact that that's what I'm doing. Wow, I said that. Can't take that back. Okay. and for me, polyamory, you know, I'm not judging polyamory as a lifestyle. There's a lot of people that it works for, and that's cool. But for me, polyamory was very much about not wanting to be abandoned and feeling that that my needs were too much. And I think for me, polyamory definitely came as like a buffer against cheating. It's like, well, if we just take cheating out of the equation, if we just have an open relationship, then you won't ever have a reason to leave me. And wow, I can't take that back either. Wow, this video got more complicated than I thought it would. But essentially, those were all the things that that I was called to give up in the past year. And if you know me at all, I've been the biggest proponent of non-monogamy. I'm still not like on the totally monogamous side necessarily, but I've realized that like wanting that primacy and wanting to be prioritized, that there's nothing shameful in that, and that if non-monogamy is gonna happen in a relationship, it should come from a place of abundance, not from a place of me feeling like I'm making up for the fact that somebody can't have sex with anybody else if they're gonna be with me. You know, like, that's just silly. I was the biggest proponent of non-monogamy. I was the biggest proponent of seduction. I'm literally a seduction coach. I was the loudest self-identified submissive that I knew. Like, this is ridiculous. And I saw how all of these things were holding me back. There's a quote from Sri Krishna Menon that says, that which a man considers his virtues arrests his development far greater than that which he considers his faults. And I've really seen the truth in that quote, because if we think that I was like, I'm the best submissive and I'm like, I'm such a great seductress and blah, blah, blah. And I was like holding all these things so near and dear to my heart, but really there were a lot of ways that those things were impeding my growth. So I anticipate that in the future, I will figure out also how to reintegrate them and to adopt them as practices rather than identifiers. You know, that's the difference. If it's a practice, it's something that I can pick up and put down. It's something I can do, like archery. You know, I could pick up archery and I could go and do it and I could be good at it, but I don't need to like walk around with a quiver and arrow on my back all the time, you know, and say, this is who I, you know, I'm Katniss, whatever. Like, that's a lame analogy, but whatever, you get what I mean. It's a practice rather than an identifier. So what I'm saying is that is how hard it was for me to go through this last year of spiritual growth. Those are the things that I was called to give up. Like, and now I'm like, well, who the fuck am I? You know? And of course, we can see that as being lost, or we can see that as being like having limitless possibilities. So that's pretty cool. I'm not really worried. I feel like I've been guided so far. The universe has yet to let me down. Everything feels like progress, even when that progress has been difficult. But I feel okay. I think that the next steps will keep presenting themselves. And again, it's like the next steps keep presenting themselves, right? I'm not there yet, because we live in the fourth dimension, and this is why we have the element of time, because things need time to grow. And one of my oracle decks has a card about like not rushing things, and it says this great analogy in the interpretation where it's like, when you plant a seed in the ground, as soon as something sprouts, do you go and pull it up? No, because you'd kill it. You know, you can't expect it to be done by that point. It takes more time. There's a reason why we plant a seed, and there's, you know, three seasons in between that and the harvest. We don't plant a seed and then immediately get there. And if we did, it would be a shock to our system. It would be a refeeding syndrome. So I want us all to really have compassion for other people and where they're at. I've been going through this with someone who was pretty close to me, and it's really hard because in my perception, they've gotten, you know, they went so far, and then they hit a wall where their next step would involve giving up a belief that is really entrenched and near and dear to them, but is holding them back. And it's like looking at a child and like wanting to rip their teddy bear out of their hands, man. That's how spiritual growth is sometimes. And they have to want to do it. And we can't, we have to show compassion. And also, you know, we can't rescue people. And I think that understanding this, just this idea that things don't happen all at once, you know? We're not actually in the fifth dimension, you guys, where there is no time. We are three-dimensional beings who are living in the fourth direction, the fourth dimension. And, you know, I'm not going to show up tonight with a Christmas present for the friends I'm hanging out with, because it's March, you know? And I understand where this can be a source of conflict. It can be really difficult because, you know, maybe you're riding a car and a person that you love very much is like next to you on a moped, and you get to a point where you outpace them and you have to just accept the fact that, you know, you can offer them a ride in your car, but they have to take you up on it. And, you know, meanwhile, you may also have a friend in the spiritual community who's like in an F1 formula racing car, you know, and you may look at them and you may judge yourself next to them. And it's cool. You can say, hey, I want to upgrade my car and see, you know, how that, like that, you can make that choice and try and do that. That's certainly what I've done in this past year, is I've been like, all right, I'm ready to get real with myself. I want to just take the elevator to the top floor. But please understand that that has been difficult. That has been really, really hard. And that there have been days where if I am flooded with information, if I start to realize things about myself, then there's been days where I couldn't get out of bed for days at a time. That's real. And I'm very lucky that I have a really flexible work schedule. I'm really lucky that I can schedule my work and my gigs and my clients and my sessions around what I need to do. And so much of why I think I have been a little slow this year on building my business, I'm just now starting to be like, okay, let's get it together. I feel like I'm starting to gain enough ground where I want to start getting that momentum going. But there's so many things I wanted to have done that I haven't. And part of that is because all of this growth has taken so much time and so much bandwidth. And you guys, we live in a shit economy right now, you know? And it's hard for people to take that time when you have to go to work and make rent and take care of yourself on a mundane level, on a physical level. You don't always have the luxury of staying in bed for 3 days at a time. And I mean that literally. I mean, like, I could not find the strength to get out of bed, and I wasn't physically ill. I was lightheaded. These things have physical effects, at least for me they do. And I know for several others they do as well. You know, I feel shaky. I feel tingly. There's a reason I wanted to do this video before I left for the concert tonight, because I didn't want to be there with all of this stuff in me. You know, when I write something or do a video or put it out there, it feels like a fever breaking. It feels like, okay, now it's out there. And it's not, you know, it's an extraction. It's, you know, it's not in me fucking with my system anymore. Now it's a thing that I've put outside of myself that I can point to, which makes it a lot easier. And then I feel like, okay, it's done. I've processed it. This is, you know, I'm glad you guys get things out of these videos and out of my posts and my writing and all the other stuff that I do. I hope you do anyway, but for me, like, you're helping me too. By witnessing me, you are helping me in my processing, and I'm incredibly grateful to all of you for that. So yeah, spiritual growth is hard. And it's sold to us as awesome, and it is awesome. It's so great. And, you know, and I look at my friend who has run up against a really difficult belief to let go of. And I'm looking at that and saying, you know, I really need to be detached from outcome. And if she wants to hang on to that teddy bear longer, then that's just how it's gotta be. But at the same time, I also hope, you know, I hope that years from now, or whenever that person chooses to, that they'll, you know, that it really will improve their lives a great deal. So it is, it's terrific, it's great. If it wasn't, we wouldn't be doing it. But I think that in the spiritual community, especially because there are so many people who want to sell you enlightenment, and like, shit, I'm one of them, you guys. Like, yeah, I want you to get coaching sessions with me. Like, yeah, I want to help you make your lives better. But it's easy for people who study marketing to just package it and sell it to you. I think that's why I'm a little uncomfortable with a lot of marketing in ways that actually probably hold my business back. I'll probably work out those kinks sometime in the near future. And figure out my exact relationship to that. But it's so easy for us to be like, this is awesome, this is great, you know, come join us, or, you know, like, come over the light side, we have cookies, you know, like, it's easy for that to happen. And it's really easy for us to underestimate how difficult it is for people who are actually going through that process, especially when we've already been through it ourselves. And we're on the other side of it, and we're like, oh, it's great, it's so cool. It always feels easier in hindsight, and it's hard to remember how difficult it was to go through it in the first place. As with anything that is a difficult experience that we've been through that has made us better. You know, it's like getting on a roller coaster. It's like, you know, being a little kid, and you're like terrified, and you're like, oh my God, that roller coaster is so scary, I don't wanna go. And then you're on it, and you're like, oh, that was great, that was fine. But you forget how scary it is, like, when you're going up and you're looking down and you're seeing all the tiny people looking like ants, and you're like, why did I do this? Why did I do this? And we forget that, what that feeling is of like, why did I do this? Why did I do this? And I've been in ceremonies where I'm like, why did I do this? This is awful. And I've emerged that much better for them. And hopefully every time we go through that experience, we can at least keep that memory in our minds of being like, well, I've been here before, and I'm just going to get through it. And when I get to the other side, it'll be better. But especially for people who are just embarking on that path, it's hard. So please remember, we have the element of time for a reason. I often look back at some of the information I've gotten, some, you know, readings or intuition or whatever it was. And I look and I'm like, wow, that's interesting, because 6 months out was accurate. After 6 months, everything changed. And I look back and sometimes I'm like, well, that reader was wrong. And then I'm like, actually, maybe that's what I needed to know at that point in time to keep going. If someone had told me the thing you want is not going to come into fruition until over a year from now, would I have stuck it out? Would I have said, well, I'll just wait till a year from now and then I'll worry about it, which would mean that I would not have gone through all the necessary steps that I needed to go through during that year to reach that next point? I think that's something interesting to think about. Again, refeeding syndrome. If we tell someone everything right away, they're not going to get to those points. And I want you to also think about that in this political climate as well, because there's so many of us, especially on the left, that want to just drop those who disagree with us into our pool of liberalism, not realizing that even if we think we're saving them from their own chains of capitalism or internalized misogyny, let's really be careful not to shock their systems. Like, let's really be careful rather than even if our intentions are so good, rather than just throwing all this information at them, you know, just tossing them in a giant pool of, you know, liberation. Let's concentrate on giving them the next step that they would need to get there. And that's hard too, you guys. That's hard to look at someone and say, what is just the next step that they need? Not I'm gonna correct all their beliefs because they're wrong and I'm right, but what is the next thing that they would need to go on that journey? Let's remember, let's look at that and say, what nutrients can I give this starving person that's going to help their system readjust to normalcy? Even when they're doing it to themselves, you know, refeeding syndrome happens in anorexics too. It doesn't make it any less real or any less difficult. So, let's all have compassion. Let's try and zoom out and see where everyone's at in their journeys. Let's not judge them for not being farther along. And let's remember that they might not be capable physically. Their bodies may not be physically capable of where you're at right now. But we can certainly help people. We can serve as examples, and we can encourage them and give them the support they need to take the next steps. And that's why we have time. So thanks for listening, and I love you all, and let's all try and be kind, myself included. Night night.